So today we start a new topic, GE coverings. As we have told earlier, the covering space theory has three main point of view. Among them, the viewpoint of group action is the most ancient. Due to people like Grothendieck, this ancient point of view has become in the forefront now. In this last chapter for this course, we should exploit this viewpoint and reap some wonderful harvest. Among these, proof of various forms of Seifert-von-Kampmann theorem is the foremost. Let us introduce some convenient terminology, this time bringing out the group action in the foreground. By a G covering, we mean a total space in the projection map P, the bottom space B. Okay, wherein P is a covering projection, and this map is the quotient map of an even action of the group G on E. Okay, we have already seen that whenever a group G acts evenly on a topological space through diffeomorphisms, the quotient map is a covering projection. So far we have been studying covering projections without much regard to the group action. Now we want to bring the group action in the foreground. Though, in principle, all the examples that we have discussed are G coverings. Okay, they come out of group action of a group. So let us make a few definitions here. Suppose you have two G coverings. One is EPB, another one E prime, P prime, B prime. So I am denoting them as I and Xi prime. A map between them earlier was just a map from E to E prime, which commuted with the projection maps. So what we are taking here is the base space is the same. The map should be such that it is respecting the G action on both sides. So it's G equivariant map. Alpha of GZ equal to G of alpha Z. This should happen for every G in G, Z in A. Such a thing will be called a G map, okay? Once it's a G map, automatically it happens that P prime composite alpha would be equal to P. Why? Because both P and P prime are quotients. They are taking the equivalence classes by the G action to the same element. So they are quotients given by the G action. So automatically, if alpha is respecting G, so it will have P prime composite alpha. Okay. Once you have this, you can talk about another map, say beta from E prime to another G covering, say E double prime. Then the composite will be also a G map. The composite of G maps is G maps makes it into a category, whatever it is, okay? So this you have to just remember that you can take composites and identity map is there and so on. Composition is associative. These are the basic things that we have further. Now, two G coverings will be called G equivalent if there is a G map between them, which is a homeomorphism. If it were not a G map, just a homeomorphism, then remember that was the meaning of covering equivalence. Equivalence classes of coverings have been studied thoroughly and we have even classified them earlier. Classification of covering projections was that topic. Now we are putting extra condition, namely the covering transformation that we are taking must be respecting the action of G. Okay, so it must be G map, then we call it a G equivalent. Okay, clearly G equivalence is also an equivalence relation. It's a stronger equivalence relation. If two things are G equivalent, then they are the covering transformation. They are as covering projections, they are equivalent. But here is somewhat unexpected gift, you can say, unexpected and very important one. Namely, every G map of G coverings, the base space is the same, remember all the time, over a single base space, is automatically a G isomorphism. You don't have to assume that in the definition we had is a homeomorphism. This is not necessary at all. Automatically this homeomorphism comes. That is the meaning of this one. Not only that, once it is homeomorphism, inverse is there. Inverse is also G map. That is very easy. Okay, because that is algebra. Okay. So if a group homomorphism is invertible, automatically the inverse is a group homomorphism. It is just like that. Okay, but why it is a homeomorphism? So that is the beauty here. It is not very surprising, but it is a mild surprise, but present one. So let us go through this proof. Take alpha from E to be a such a map means it's a G map. As we have seen, once it's a G map, it goes fibers to fibers, right? Because P prime composite alpha will be P. It's same thing as alpha of P inverse of B is same thing as P prime inverse of containing P prime inverse of B. It's every fiber is an orbit. Okay. For both E and S E prime, we have alpha coming from G E. G E is an orbit to G of alpha E. Okay. But now alpha of G E is G of alpha E. It follows that alpha is surjective. Every point here is G of alpha something. Okay. So if that is the case, you take G E would go to that element under alpha. So alpha is surjective by this definition. But now the action is E1. That will tell you alpha is injective also. Right? Because if alpha G1 E equal to alpha G2 E, then what happens? G1 of alpha E will be equal to G2 of alpha E. So G1 and G2 are given the same element because of fixed point freeness. G1 must be equal to G2. So this means that what we have got here is a bijection. Okay. Finally, the event of action, it also tells you that it's an open mapping. If you choose an open subset, which is evenly covered in the sense it translates or disjoint, okay, alpha of that will also have the same property. And so that will give you an open subset which is disjoint. All of them must be, you know, disjoint open sets should have been mapped to disjoint open sets. Okay, so this shows that it's a homeomorphism. Clearly, a G covering is a special type of covering projection. What I mean should say it's a covering projection, but with extra structure. Right, that's all. So also a G equivalence from E1 to E2 of two coverings obviously defines usual equivalence relation. Two things are equivalent if they are G equivalent already, but the other way around may not be true. The question is now how far the converse is true. To understand this properly, let us do some artificially looking construction here, but that seems to be the final answer. So let us see. Start with an action of G on a space E. Associate quotient map P from E to B. Now you take an automorphism of G, self automorphism. Define a new action of G on the same E by this formula, namely G of circ E. I am writing it as different notation here. G of circ E equal to phi G of E. This action on the right, it is the given action, but after taking phi. So it is twisted G action, phi G of E. Okay, and that is the action on the left side here. Now the quotient map is the same quotient map P, because whether they are related by phi G, phi is an automorphism, it's a bijection. Whether they are related by G1, G2 or phi G1, phi G2 or something, they will be related, right? So the same relation will hold for the same set of things. Therefore, the orbits are the same. Therefore, the quotients are the same. The topological space E was the same. Quotient is the same, orbit is the same. So B is the same, the map is the same. Okay, but I'm thinking of G acting on once this way and once this way. So they are different. Are they really different? To see that, I should see that there is a map from this G covering to that G covering, which is a G map. If I find that one, then they are the same in the sense of they are equivalent. The strange thing is, there may not be any such equivalence. For example, you would think everything is same, so maybe identity map itself will do. Check identity map from E to E. Is it a G map? On this side, the action is alpha of G, okay, whatever it is, by doing phi G of alpha. On the other side, it is just G of alpha it should be. G of E it should be. So that will happen only if phi G equal to G for every G. That means your phi, which is automorphism, must be identity. So identity map is not a G map whenever phi is different from identity. But there may be some other. Okay. So answer is not clear. There may be some other. So finally, what I want to say is, there is a very simple example wherein no covering transformation will be there, which is a G. So let us see that example. Okay. So let us see that example. Take the threefold covering S1 to S1 given by PZ equal to Z cube. What is the action here? Action is by the cube roots of unity. 1 omega omega square, which forms a group of order 3. The action, you go by a modulo that action, which is an even action. What you get is this map P is equal to Z cube. Okay, you get a quotient here against S1. Right? What is the Galois group of this? What are all the coverings? Obviously, let us say omega is the cube root of unity. Okay, Z going to Z, Z going to omega Z, Z going to omega square Z. So there are three different maps, they are covering transformations, right? There cannot be anything more, because the order of the covering itself is three. The fiber has only three elements. We have proved once that the group of covering transformations injects into the fiber. Therefore, what we have is, there can be at most three such covering transformations. And we have already produced three. So it must be the full group. So Galois group is exactly equal to the group of what? Cube roots of unity. Right? So we know all the covering transformations. Now you just check that none of them is a G-map. Under what I am going to produce that, namely, I have to take an automorphism of the cube roots of unity, group of three elements. Well, that is very easy. Namely, omega going to omega square is an automorphism. There is only one other identity automorphism. This is bad enough already. Omega going to omega square is an automorphism. Under that, none of this, z going to z, z going to z square, z going to, sorry, z going to omega square, omega z going to omega z, none of this is a G map. Okay? Check that. Therefore, the same covering transformation can be thought of as a G covering in more than one way. Okay? This was totally ignored in the usual study of covering transformations that we have done so far. All right. So why this is so important is precisely the question here that we are going to study, namely homomorphisms of one group to another group will be taken care here. This is an automorphism is taken care of from same group to same group. So first simple example, counterexample we have given. This is the key, namely the next theorem says, so that is what I have completely given here. This theorem says that nothing else will be wrong. This is all that is going to happen in the case of the same covering transformation. Same covering transformation, same covering projection you have taken, and only action could be different. How they are related, in what way they are related, is precisely this. Namely, start with a connected space B and connected coverings E1 and E2, which are G coverings. They are equivalent as G coverings, as covering transformations. Okay, so they are equivalent as covering transformations if and only if you have an automorphism of G, okay, and a covering transformation F from E1 to E2, such that this F becomes a G map after you twist it by phi G. On the left side, E2, you have to take a different action. What is that action? It corresponds to an automorphism. Both E1 and E2 are given an action. Okay. So if you take F of GZ here equal to G of FZ, that would have been a G map of them. But what we get is phi G of FZ. And this phi G is an automorphism. So this is the theorem. Okay. This is the difference between covering transformations, which are both G coverings or a connected space and connected. That's all. Even E2 connected, B is connected. Okay, let us prove this one. And that is some kind of satisfaction we have about introducing G coverings. Obviously, we have to prove only the if part here. Only if part we have to prove. Once it is, if this is satisfied, automatically already it is a covering transformation. Okay. So just start with the covering transformation, you should produce phi. That is the part which you have to prove. Okay, the only if part. Given a homeomorphism F from E1 to E2 such that P2 composite F equal to P1. We must produce an automorphism phi from G to G with the property that f of g z equal to phi g of x z. Okay, so fix a base point B, E1 and E1 and E2 in E2, but E2 I will take it as P1 of E1. Okay, sorry, P1 of E1 is B I have taken, then E2 I have taken F of, there is already a F which is a covering transformation, E2 I am taking it as F of E1. Obviously, P2 of E2 will be again B. Okay, this much is fine, right? Now it follows that for each G in G, there is a unique phi G. I'm going to define it such that F of GE1, look at GE1. GE1 is in the same fiber as E1. So F of that will be in the same fiber as FE1. Therefore, FE1 times whatever this element must be differing by some element of G. I call that element as phi G. So this phi G is defined by this. And it has to be unique because of the even action. So F of G E1 equal to phi G of F E1. This is happening at one single point, namely the point that we have chosen as base point. Okay. Just like in all other covering space theory, this will tell you the whole function is well defined now. Okay. Now, for a fixed G, you fix G. Consider the two maps, E1 to E2, given by one thing is E going to F of GE, another one is going to E going to PG of FE. What I am doing here, first I fixed E1 and got a G. Now I keep this G fixed, but vary the point E. Point E is varied on the entire of E1. Okay. Then I get two maps. One is E going to F of GE. G is fixed here. E is varying. Here again, G is fixed, so phi G is fixed, F of E, E is varying. So I have two maps. At E1, these two entries are the same. So there are two functions, so let us call this as some alpha and beta. Beta at E1 is equal to beta at E2, right? But what are these, what are these alpha and beta? Alpha of E1 equal to alpha, beta of E1. That is what we have shown, not E2, sorry. Alpha of E1 is equal to beta of E1. That is the meaning of this one. Okay. But both are the lifts of P1, okay, and agreeing at a point. E1 to E2, there is a P1 here, there is a P2 here to B, right? You take this, these are two maps from E1 to E2. You apply P2, what you get is P1. Apply P2 here. P2 composite F is what? P1. P1 of GE is PE. G, oh, so this is PE, P1 of E. Here, look at it. P2 of phi G of whatever is whatever. P2 goes, phi G goes away. So it's P2 of F, but P2 of F is again P1. So this is also P1, this is also P1. So they are lifts of the same map P1. Okay. They agree at one point. Therefore, they must agree everywhere. Why? Because we have assumed that E1 is connected. So they agree everywhere means just look at this one, F of GE equal to phi G of FE. Okay. So F becomes a G map, phi G map. But now we have got a Fiji, we have got a function, we have to verify that it is homomorphism, we have to verify that it is isomorphism, right? This part already says that f of g e g z equal to p of g f z for every z inside, all right? So we have to verify that this g is, phi g is, g going to phi g is an isomorphism, an automorphism of group g. Let us prove that phi is a homomorphism first. So given g1 and g2, we have to show that phi of g1 g2 equal to phi g1 into phi g2. So start with phi g1 g2 operating upon fz. This is equal to f of g1 g2 operating upon z. But g1 g2 z can be written as g1 into g2 z by associativity. By the property of f again, it is equal to f of phi of g1 into f of g2 z. Okay. Now again apply the property of f. G2 will also come out now. So that will be equal to phi g1, phi g2 into f z. Now use the evenness of the action. In particular, it's fixed point free. Therefore, what we get, phi of g1 g2 must be equal to phi g1 into phi g2. So that proves that p is a homomorphism. It remains to prove that it is injective and surjective. So let us now prove that p is injective. If phi g1, phi of g is equal to 1 for some g, then we get f of gz equal to phi g into fz by definition. But now by we have taken that phi g is 1, so it is equal to fz, which implies by the injectivity of f, f is a homeomorphism. Therefore, gz must be equal to z. But then the evenness of action, which is fixed point free, g must be identity. That proves that phi is injective. Now finally, to show that phi is surjective, given any h in g, okay, look at the element h times h operated upon e prime, where e prime is the any element, okay. So what you want to do is the following. Given any h in G by surjectivity of, there is a e prime in E such that f of e prime is h of e2, where e2 was the base point. But then e prime will be also in p1 inverse of B, because all of them are going to B. Therefore, e prime itself will be equal to G e1. Okay, I started with some e prime which goes to h of e2 under f, but this e prime must be in the same fiber with e2, therefore e prime equal to g e2, g e1 for some g inside g. Therefore, h of e2, which was f of e prime, but e prime is g e1, so it is f of g e1, which is phi g of f of e1. Now, phi g of f of e1 is just e2. Okay. Therefore, this is equal to h of e2 is equal to phi g of e2, which means by evenness of the action, h is equal to phi g. So we have produced a g such that phi g is h. So this proves the surjectivity, and therefore p is an isomorphism. So this completes the proof of that phi is a isomorphism, is an automorphism of phi, and hence completes the proof of the theorem. Thank you.